Welcome to the WWE Podcast, the most passionate and authentic wrestling analysis on the web. We've got you covered with every Raw, SmackDown, and NXT show, giving you a no bullshit opinion. We know you love wrestling. We do too. So let's get this show underway.
And that's the bottom line. What? Cause Stone Cold said so.
Hey guys, welcome to the WWE Podcast. Thank you so much for joining me on this Tuesday, February 25th, 2020. My God, February is flying, right? It's almost March. It's insane. We've got March less than a week away, and even with leap year, it's just flying by. It's going to be March in, what, freaking 5 days? 5 days is going to be March 1st. And then, my God, it's into March Madness. Baseball season starts in a month from today, I think. So, wow. It has been a very quick month of February, really a quick month of January, too. And it feels like the ball just dropped. And we're 2 months into the year. We're going into the third month. And it's just insane the way things go. You turn around and you blink and boom. I mean, a month's gone by, 2 months go by, years go by. I mean, I'm 35 years old, right? And it just seems as if the older I get, the faster time goes. I think there was a study done, and you can look it up, of the older you get, that your brain perceives time to go by faster. So I absolutely can attest to that, because as you remember, I mean, think about when you were younger, right? When you were younger, it felt like forever to get through a school day, you know, to get to, your next birthday so you can drive a car or get your license. Oh my God, when I'm 18, I can buy a pack of cigarettes and a lottery ticket. It just seems like it took forever, and just you turn around and kaboom, right? And this is another one of those examples of just, I'm having a live just moment with you guys right now. Anyway, nobody cares about that. You guys are here to talk about wrestling as we roll into full swing of WrestleMania season, but not before our beloved stop in Saudi Arabia. And that beloved stop happens in 2 days at Super ShowDown in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, as this pay-per-view is happening, whether we like it or not. And I put out a Twitter poll asking you guys, which, by the way, is at the WWE Podcast, you guys voted the biggest reason that you're not going to be watching the Super ShowDown pay-per-view is that you're choosing not to watch. And 49% of you said that. 38% that said that they're at work. Yours truly will be in that percentage. And then 13% said they just don't have the network and are not going to watch. So the majority are just choosing not to watch. And I would assume that out of those, if I was going to do a breakdown poll, that they're choosing not to watch because they don't agree with the Saudi Arabia government and culture. And obviously what happened to the reporter and all the suppression of women's rights for years and years and years and years and years. All of that thrown together, I mean, you're just asking for a PR disaster. And yes, I definitely understand that perspective. But I'll be watching because, number one, I'm a wrestling fan, okay? I understand all of the evils of the Saudi Arabia government in the past and their most recent controversy. But I'm a wrestling fan, so I don't give a damn where they're holding it. Me watching is not going to affect their dollar value either way. What WWE is paying them is in contract and set in stone. So I am not going to be, other than for my own benefit in my mind, I'm going to be benefiting it if I don't watch it. And, well, I prove them wrong by not watching it. Okay, this is a protest. If you're protesting it, you're doing it because of your own beliefs, not because you actually believe that it's going to have effect on any kind of numbers or dollar amounts going to Saudi Arabia. But I certainly understand the premise behind it and the narrative behind it. I get it. But I'll be watching, and I'll be watching on delay like the majority of people. So it should be, I think it should be a good show. I know that many people are poo-pooing this. And while from a predictability standpoint, this may be one of the most predictable pay-per-views on paper that we've ever seen. And not that I'm advocating for an unpredictable outcome, because the predictability of this is good. If you get a predictable outcome for the majority of these matches, that's what you're looking for, because I don't need shockers for shock value here. This is a pay-per-view that is kind of by the numbers. It's got some big names. It's got a lot of rumors circulating of The Undertaker in Saudi Arabia, so I don't know what that's about. Maybe he interrupts the AJ Styles win of the trophy. I mean, who knows? A lot of rumors floating around about AJ Styles versus Undertaker this year. So this is just a pay-per-view that is shrouded in a dark cloud, has big names, should be relatively short, I would hope. I'm sure Mansoor will make a hometown hero's welcome and some kind of impact there, as Saudi Arabia has their hometown boy to cheer for. And, you know, again, this is a pay-per-view many of you will protest, and I understand that. But anyway, we have today Michael Gross joining us to discuss Raw, a little bit of the current product. I get his rundown of Super Showdown predictions at the end of the show, so stay tuned for that. But it's always a pleasure to have him on. I'm glad that we've been able to connect, even if it's not for a long amount of time. I know I got some very positive feedback with him on the show last time, so I wanted to bring him back, and certainly great to talk to, and nothing will go faster than talking to somebody about wrestling that is also a wrestling fan. I'm serious. If you are a wrestling fan and you have friends or family members that are wrestling fans and you talk with them about wrestling, it is something that you get lost in time with. And you just, it's almost as if you experience the phenomenon called lost time when you discuss wrestling, because it just goes in the blink of an eye. I mean, we only had an hour together to discuss it, and it felt like 5 minutes. So it was great while it lasted. We'll have him on the show again in the near future whenever our schedules are able to be lined up. So have no fear. But the schedule for the rest of the week, for those interested, I'm going to be doing a wrestling nostalgia tomorrow, and it may be a retro wrestling nostalgia, meaning I may pull a wrestling nostalgia out of the hat, out of our vault, and publish it tomorrow for those that may not have heard it. Because as this show grows, maybe you didn't know that we did a wrestling nostalgia on whatever topic that we did, you know, maybe a year ago or 2 years ago. This show is now 300 episodes old. I did have another show before this one, but I will not mention the name because I don't want people digging it out. But I'm sure if you followed me for years, you may know the name. But this isn't the 300th episode I've done as a whole, but under the WWE podcast umbrella, this is the, well, actually 301 now, episodes old. So it's been quite an adventure, especially over the last year. The last year has really exploded with growth, and I have to attribute that to all the great co-hosts I've had, the guest co-hosts, those that contribute their time and energy to make this grow, and anybody who has dedicated their time to write a blog for me as well, for the website, not really for me, for the website, for all of you, is certainly to thank. I feel like I'm at an Oscars, award speech, but that's true. It is not me doing this by myself. It is certainly all of the great co-hosts that we have that dedicate their time to helping this show grow, and will continue to help this show grow, I hope, as we move along. I truly believe this is going to be a show that is in the top 10, top 5 podcasts in the next year. I know we've been fluctuating all over the place. And by the way, anybody can go look at any ranking for anybody at any time. It's called chartable.com. You just type in someone's podcast. It's not secret. It's public info. And you can see the rank history that they've ever been on and what chart and for how long, all that kind of stuff. And lately we've been hanging out in like the 40s, and I'm like, what the hell's going on? So I'm thinking that larger podcasts have gotten the hint that the wrestling category has opened up on iTunes. So whatever, it's fine. I love competition, and we will continue to scratch and claw our way back up into the top 20, top 15, which is where we kind of live for months and months and months. So you guys continue to make that happen. I appreciate it. All the downloads. Tell a friend if you want this show to continue and you want it to grow, hit that like and subscribe button and give us a rating and review and tell a friend, right? All right, well, that is enough for me, guys. And, you know, I know that we, myself and Michael, discussed Monday Night Raw. We didn't get to every aspect of the show due to time constraints. And while we covered a lot of the big things, there were some things that happened that I never got to really give you guys my thoughts on. One of them being Brock Lesnar and Paul Heyman. And, I mean, I don't know what there really is to say about that, other than it was kind of your standard Paul Heyman, you know, cutting a promo for Brock Lesnar as he stands there and gets paid an exorbitant amount of money to look menacing and wear his Suplex City in the local city t-shirt, right? Man, that guy has got it made. And I am a fan of Brock Lesnar. I always have been. He is the measuring stick. He can't ever cut a good promo, but he is one of the few and probably the only wrestler in the history of WWE that I know that can reach the level of success that Brock has without ever being able to cut a good promo himself. So it's a testament to Brock, testament certainly to Paul Heyman, who's been able to be his external brain, as Drew McIntyre called it, for so many years. So I mean, it was what it was this past week, with Heyman coming out and declaring another spoiler and saying basically that Ricochet has zero chance, and that if his aunt had balls that he'd be his uncle, and if is not going to happen, right? I mean, that made Jerry Lawler pop, and I found it pretty funny too. It was just, again, your typical very good promo from Paul Heyman, and coming out there and just really looking past Ricochet. And which is fine, because I think we all should, to get to the real opponent of Drew McIntyre. So I didn't have a whole lot to say other than it was kind of your status quo on that. Another thing that happened that myself and Michael didn't get to talk about, I mean, with Eric Rowan and Aleister Black, again, Aleister Black unceremoniously beat Eric Rowan the last time these two met, last week or the week before. And to me, it should have felt like a bigger deal, right? You had Eric Rowan being built up throughout the entire summer, being the guy that assaulted Roman Reigns and then loses unceremoniously to Aleister Black, who's been on a hot streak himself. And this week, more competitive, longer match, and it took two Black Masses, but eventually Aleister Black won again. Sarah Schreiber stood at the top of the ramp at the end of this and asked Black how he overcame the 3-on-1 attack and still won tonight's matchup. And he said, rage, unbridled rage. And he said that if that's too cryptic, next week he and AJ Styles will fight. So Black walked off and still holding his ribs. So I'm glad that Aleister Black is at least moving on to the next level here. I'm sure AJ Styles will not be as easily steamrolled, and nor should he be if it's going to be a AJ Styles Undertaker WrestleMania bound match. So at least Aleister Black is moving on from basically obscurity to the next level. It's good to see. The other thing that I wanted to discuss that we really didn't get to was the Montez Ford-Seth Rollins match. Montez Ford here, as silly as he was last week, acting like Ultimate Warrior with his eyes rolled back, shaking the ropes like a you know, 5-year-old would do if he got into the ring for the first time, would be the thing I want to say is Montez Ford really showed himself here. And I'm not being facetious. I'm being positive. I'm singing his praises here, because I think he had his biggest match of his career to date, certainly, against Seth Rollins, a top flight guy. And yes, you're working against a top flight guy, which helps you look good, but in his own right, Montez Ford was very good here in the ring. I loved the way that these two worked together. It wasn't the longest match, but it showed that Montez Ford can go. Seth Rollins won clean, as he should. Not just because you're a babyface doesn't mean you have to win clean. You can win clean as a heel too. And that's what I liked here from Seth. I like that Seth brought back the possibility of doing a pedigree. That adds another weapon to his arsenal. It was just a good showing from Montez Ford beyond the Monday night updates or whatever stupid crap that they were doing, basically mocking Saturday Night Live. It was just god awful doing that stuff. The stuff that Vince loves and Kevin Dunn loves. That's the stuff that are career killers and are only good for an audience of two. This stuff inside the ring, showing what you can do against a top flight guy, gets you another opportunity. So I think Montez Ford in a loss truly won here. So that is a big deal. And the other thing, we did mention this in the show, so I won't give away the lead too much, but with Beth Phoenix being hyped to return next week to provide a medical update on her husband Edge, just think about that. Beth is in the building. Randy Orton's in the building. What could happen to Beth? Let's just think about that. I have three letters, and I think we can all say them in unison. But I'll leave that to you, and to hear my thoughts and Michael's thoughts on that possibility, which we jump into pretty early on in our conversation. So overall, I like this show. The ending was a little wonky with the referee. We also discussed that, the referee suddenly being crooked as if he was bought out or Seth threatened him. We don't know the story, but the referee that was crooked and ended up in the main event of Kevin Owens versus Randy Orton ended up screwing Kevin Owens in a fast three count and ended up being on the receiving end of a stunner was interesting. And again, I mentioned in the show that it's nice having Kevin Owens not be on laying flat on his back at the end of a show. So it was a nice momentum building, the all important word momentum, WWE. Did you hear me? I'm sure you'd be proud of Kevin Owens getting a little bit of steam. He needs to keep moving. He needs to that forward type of progress. And it seems as if he's been stuck in a rut lately. This week, he seemed to climb himself out at least a little bit. He's poking his head up out of that hole. And let's see if he can get himself completely out. I think the key will be follow-up. I don't need Kevin Owens going back to his old ways of being booked into, just keep fighting. Just keep fighting. I'm going to keep fighting. And that's what his shirt says. But if you keep fighting and keep getting knocked on your ass, eventually it's not just going to be people looking at you with the perception of, oh my God, look at all the guts. This guy's got guts. He just keeps getting up. You can't put him down. Instead, it's going to transform into, you are a damn fool for just going out there with the same game plan and getting your ass kicked every single time. Eventually, it goes from guts and determination and perseverance to, you're a dumbass. And I think he was bordering on that, and he certainly started to reverse that this week on Raw, and I was happy about that. But it started to morph into that. I mean, that's why I think Kevin was starting to lose some momentum. But he won't have Samoa Joe to back him up. As we know, Samoa Joe failed a wellness test. So not good for Samoa Joe. On top of his injuries, I have a feeling Vince McMahon is starting to lose confidence in Samoa Joe ever being a top guy with those things happening, especially simultaneously. So not looking good for Joe. He gets moved from commentary, gets injured twice, and then fails a wellness test. Yikes. So overall, again, solid, solid Raw. Winnipeg was hot. Amazing how when they're not ashamed of the city, you hear people talking about it throughout the commentators mentioning it multiple times, to the actual performers, wrestlers mentioning it several times, and there's that actual graphic of the city. And if they're ashamed of your city, don't worry, they'll tell you the state. But if it seriously means that they are ashamed to be in your city if they don't mention the city. There's no other reason. It's simply ego and perception. So tell me I'm wrong. And you could say, oh, well, and I agree that it's probably partially the perception on Wall Street or the perception to their sponsors that they're not in big cities every single week. So maybe that's a part of it too. But don't worry, Winnipeg, you are on the good list, not on the naughty list. And next week, certainly, wait till we see how many times next week we hear the word Brooklyn. Let's do the over-under on that. I'm going to say 15 is the over-under on Brooklyn. Don't worry, they will make it known, the city, next week until it's shoved down your throat and you regurgitate it. So get ready, Brooklyn. You are going to get your 15 minutes of fame, or 3 hours of fame in Raw's case, next week. So it's just very striking now how different it is from city to city, depending on how they perceive that city to be worthy of mentioning on the air. It's just so small of them. Okay, I mention that every week because it starts to piss me off more and more every week. But let's get to the conversation with Michael. And again, great conversation. Can't wait to have him back. So enjoy it. I'll be back tomorrow in probably a retro show for your wrestling nostalgia. I'll pull one from the vault. And then the reason I'm doing that and pulling it from the vault and an old one is to, number one, I want to make sure that I have time with my family, because I don't want to, I literally don't have time to do another all new show. Every single minute of my week is planned out. But I'm going to be doing a review show for the Super Showdown. And I'm going to be doing that Friday. So that is why I am moving really my live recording from tomorrow to Friday, but you'll still get your wrestling nostalgia tomorrow. So it's kind of a win-win. I'm going to give you guys, you know, your nostalgia, but also be able to give you that instant feedback to Super Showdown on Friday. So, all right, let's get to it. I know I'm rambling. Let's get to Michael and myself as we discuss Raw, Super Showdown, and more. So thanks, guys. And you know what? I'll talk to you next time. All right, everybody, welcome to the WWE Podcast as we welcome back Michael Gross, a now two-time host of the show, co-host of the show, and we are here to discuss Monday Night Raw, Super Showdown, the WWE product in general. So, Michael, welcome back. It's a really good to have you back, and I know that the listeners are excited too.
Thank you very much. I'm very humbled to be on the show once again, and I just want to say to everybody who's reached out to me from the last time, that it was very awesome to hear the amount of feedback I had. So let's discuss some stuff, man.
Definitely. Let's do it. I mean, right now to me, the first thing I'm thinking about is Randy Orton. And his progress continues on Monday night, the routine of Monday night with Randy Orton coming out at the top of the show and giving us another really kind of half explanation. Except this time it was Kevin Owens interrupting him, asking him for an explanation as to why he did what he did to Edge and to Matt Hardy, and yet he didn't give an answer. I loved Kevin Owens' promo. Might have been his best fiery babyface promo that he's had to date. I loved it, talking about how he grew up watching Edge. He took that away from him. It was very heartfelt. And Randy Orton said, you don't want to go down that road, setting up a match for later that night. So what's your take on this next chapter of the Randy Orton heel turn and really Kevin Owens now injecting himself into the program?
I love where Orton's going with everything. I have this feeling that Orton is establishing himself as just the number one heel. And I think anybody who's a top tier babyface is going to get some piece of Orton at some point. I think this is going to continue. I like it because Orton's a natural heel. He always has been. It just works for him so well. Going back to the somewhat insanity view of his character is probably one of the best things they needed for him to keep it fresh. But I also loved what it did for Owens. I love how Owens is also putting over Edge. Everything in it just seems so a flashback to 20 years ago, talking about when they were young and talking about, you know, this is what I always wanted. You took it away. So now I'm going to take it out on you. I love it. I like where it's going. I like Randy not giving answers. But ultimately, at the end of the day, I need to see where it's going to go with Randy building up to the Edge match, because they're going to have to interject somebody in between, somebody concrete. So if it's going to be Orton and Edge at WrestleMania, we need somebody in the middle to be that speed bump or that I'm standing up for Edge officially. It's not going to be Raw. It's going to be, you know, something a little bit bigger.
I think it will be. There has to be a bridge to Edge, and right now they could continue down this path of just the weekly person to come out and demand an explanation only to get beat down. And interestingly, though, next week Beth Phoenix was advertised to be on Raw in Brooklyn to give an explanation, or to give rather an update on Edge's status, his health status. And I had come up with, actually, I shouldn't take that credit. Ashley, one of our co-hosts, came up with a theory that if Beth Phoenix was to come back to television, that Randy Orton would interject himself and give her an RKO and just really, really set the heat on him, like pour gasoline on his heat. I mean, it would be nuclear heat. And I do think that that is actually what's going to happen in Brooklyn, is our Randy Orton RKOing Beth Phoenix. So do you think that's a possibility, or do you think maybe they wouldn't go there because it is TV PG and maybe it's not needed? What are your thoughts?
Honestly, I think she's going to eat an RKO. It's a foregone conclusion. And the way I can justify that is, you look at the return of the intergender matches we had prior in the year. So, to me, I think they're leaning towards that as far as giving her the RKO. I don't see it as male on female violence prolonged. I'm one, not a fan of that whole kind of thing, but I think that they kind of tested the waters with the Seth Rollins, Becky Lynch intergender tag matches, and Mike Kanellis tapping out to Becky Lynch and things like that. So yeah, I definitely see the heat is going to get turned up. It's going to be nuclear hot, and I can't wait, because it's just going to make this thing explode into a whole new dimension.
I'm with you. I don't, if they don't pull the trigger on this, it is a huge, huge missed opportunity. I mean, not only has Randy Orton taken out Edge, taken out Matt Hardy, threatened to take out, or will take out Beth Phoenix. I mean, you add all that up, and it just continues to build to Edge's return, and want you to see him, like Edge, absolutely destroy Randy Orton, given what he's got coming. This is really old school booking. This is some kind of heat that I have not seen in WWE in years and years and years. This feels genuine. It's not the cool heel. It's not an entertaining Randy Orton. This is an Orton getting genuine hatred from the fans, and I'm loving it. I'm loving every angle of it. So if they don't hit an RKO on Beth Phoenix next week, I don't know what they're doing. But boy, oh boy, I can't wait to see it. I don't need to see Edge back until maybe a week before Mania, or not until WrestleMania. I'm willing to wait this one out and take the slow burn. And to your theory, that would indeed mean that there needs to be somebody to bridge this between now and with Orton and Orton and Edge at WrestleMania. So I'm not sure who that could be. You would think Kevin Owens, but Kevin Owens and Seth Rollins seem to be on a collision course to WrestleMania as well, and I don't think they need to muddy the waters with Owens being in two separate major storylines. But I'm not sure who that could be. You have any ideas of who that bridge could be for Orton?
The perfect person, I think, is Jeff Hardy. It just makes the most sense to me. Avenging his brother, avenging his longtime rival of Edge. However, I've heard that Jeff's going to come back on the SmackDown side of things, but he'd be the perfect person to fit right in there. He can work Orton. I think that you've already got a story in place. You know, you retired my brother from WWE. You took out a man that I respect because he was my longtime rival, and we established each other. It just writes itself. What do you think?
Yeah, I'm with you on that. It has to be someone that, if Randy Orton dispatches of him, it's not going to be of any real consequence to the future of that person. And Jeff Hardy kind of fits the bill. Jeff Hardy's a guy that is a legacy star, as Randy is, a guy that is not the future of WWE, a guy that it's a feel-good moment when he's back, and it's nice and nostalgic, and he's got about 80% of what he used to. But I think he can easily take a loss to Randy Orton, you know, and that I think is a perfect fit. And then maybe Jeff Hardy suffers the same fate as Matt Hardy and as Edge. I mean, there is going to be some serious payback coming for Randy, and I'm begging to see it, and I'm really looking forward to this feud. So, but moving on to another part to Kevin Owens' night was Kevin Owens and Seth Rollins having that bit of a stare down at the end, and the crooked referee interjecting himself into that match. And I'm not sure what to make of this referee. The announcers seem to pin it off as him being a disciple of Randy or a disciple of Seth Rollins. And while that may be the case, I'm a bit split. Number one, we haven't had a crooked referee in WWE in many years, so I didn't see it coming, and bravo to the writing on that one. And I'm not sure what prompted Kevin Owens to tear off the referee shirt. You would think that would be something that the referee would do himself to reveal him as a disciple. I don't know if this referee is going to transform into an actual, you know, wrestler or performer. I don't recognize him from what I've heard. I think he's just a referee, maybe a one-off and from the independent scene that they're going to pin as a disciple. But nonetheless, Randy gets the three count, a very quick three count by this referee. Owens ends up giving him a stunner and then power bombing him through a table, which was satisfying to see. And it was nice that Kevin Owens it was nice that a Monday Night Raw happened where Kevin Owens wasn't looking up at the lights after another beatdown, which was, I think, extremely important for him as a babyface. So I enjoyed the end of Raw, but what did you make of this whole crooked referee angle?
See, I've been thinking about this. The last time I can remember a crooked ref was Brad Maddox. And they obviously turned that into an angle because he was too small of a guy to be a wrestler, but too talented to stick down in NXT doing nothing. Now, I don't know who this guy is either. And I've been searching all over the internet. All I can think is local talent. I agree with you. I don't know why Owens mysteriously just felt the need to tear his shirt off to reveal the t-shirt. The big turnoff for me was the look on the ref's face when he had the shirt torn off, like he was confused, like, am I supposed to be here? You know? That one, I was like, it was just a bad angle, as far as camera work. Now, I usually see something like the fast count and crooked ref thing to be more of a pay-per-view thing, or more of a blow-off kind of thing, or a way to elevate somebody. I don't really think this elevated Owens. I agree that it's great for the show to go off the air without him counting the ring lights, but can we get the guy a win, a solid win? Let's just get him one W. Let's get him some more of that babyface momentum that he needs, because it's making him look foolish week after week with the whole Seth Rollins thing. I also like the fact that Seth Rollins is trying to goad Randy Orton with sliding the chairs in and things like that, and channel your inner anger and listen to the voices. So I'm curious if he's trying to lure Orton into his stable. But I will say it was refreshing to have a different kind of ending for Raw with the crooked ref. It's just I would have saved it for something just a little bit bigger.
Yeah, I could see that, where it's a big match, something at stake, maybe at Elimination Chamber or something like that. I'm with you on that. And while, yes, Kevin Owens does need a win, you know, it feels like he hasn't won a match in like a month. You know, at least it's a baby step in the right direction of him not, you know, unconscious at the end of Raw. That's a good thing. And, I don't know if they're teasing Randy possibly joining this group. I wouldn't do it. And the reason I wouldn't do it is because Randy and Seth are on parallel courses. They're both top heels. And Seth's got a good thing going. Randy's got a really good thing going. It's one of those things that on paper may sound good to combine forces. It would be kind of like when the Ministry of Darkness and the Corporation joined, right? It didn't work. And yes, there were many, many, many more people involved in that with the corporate ministry, but it was very watered down. It didn't feel right, and I don't see Randy Orton joining this group to play second fiddle to Seth Rollins, who is the unspoken leader of that faction, the unnamed faction. So I don't see it happening. I think that they'll go their separate ways, and I think that was pretty defined this past week when Randy didn't get the concerto on Kevin Owens. It was just a quick three count. And then it was really Seth trying to get Randy to deliver that move, while Randy just obviously didn't get the opportunity and ended up leaving, and it came down to the final stare down with Seth and Kevin Owens. So assuming that that is the match at WrestleMania, I mean, I would assume that. I think that's a safe assumption. That's the path we're on with Kevin and Seth. I mean,
definitely.
It just seems, though, that it would be a match that we've kind of seen over and over in different variations and tag matches and things. I would think if they're going to WrestleMania to do this, that there has to be something bigger at stake or somebody bigger involved, unless it's going to be a one-on-one. If it's one-on-one, I don't know what could be at stake. There's no championships on the line. And obviously, I mean, I wouldn't think that Kevin Owens is interested in becoming a Raw Tag Team Champion with Samoa Joe, who obviously is now out with a wellness violation. So where do you think this could end up at WrestleMania? What stipulations could be at stake? Or is it just a straight-up one-on-one match?
Well, where I see it going is, obviously, if it's going to be a one-on-one match, you have to move the tag titles off of Rollins and Buddy Murphy, which I'm still going to call him Buddy Murphy. I don't want to call him Murphy, but that's we're not going to sidebar today. So I could see Owens costing Rollins and Murphy the titles, and that sets up more of a somewhat of a blow off. However, like you said, you have to have something bigger, because Rollins is made a fool of Owens time and time again. So just a win doesn't really mean anything. It has to be bigger. It has to be over the top. It has to be something for us to sink our teeth into. We got a lot of potatoes. Now we need the meat. You know, if we're going to have dinner, we got to have every course. So you've given us all these appetizers, and what is it? So I see maybe the Street Profits winning the titles off of Buddy Murphy and Rollins with the help of Kevin Owens, and almost in a humiliating way. It has to be something like, I even go a little old school, maybe strip him down to his skivvies or something like that. Just something goofy, but something that embarrasses Rollins enough to where you want to see him get to that Randy Orton level of nuclear fire heat, and he wants to kill Kevin Owens, and we're going to have this just no holds barred crazy match, and we're going to want to see it and just keep having them go at it, almost like those pull apart segments that you would have with like Brock and Strowman, or Brock and Reigns. It could work. We've got a month, a little bit over, a month plus. So if we remove those titles, we humiliate Rollins, and then we just have Rollins just always going after him, and Owens just standing tall at the end of it. Then I could feel, all right, we have something. We don't have to put a title on it. We've removed titles from the situation. We got this. So what do you think of that?
I'm with you. I'm with you as long as they keep these two separate from having a one-on-one match until Mania, if you're going to build to that, because we have seen them, as I said, in multiple variations in tag matches. And yes, I think ultimately Kevin Owens is going to cost Murphy. I know I keep just knee-jerking to Buddy Murphy, and as you said, it is very hard not to get on that bandwagon or sidetrack. But with Buddy Murphy, I think ultimately Buddy Murphy may take the pinfall, just because if you're trying to protect the bigger guy on the team, they wouldn't usually lose. But if you're going to create a feud between the two, you're going to have Kevin Owens cost Seth Rollins directly, and maybe he'll take the pinfall from the Street Profits, who seem to be really the only formidable team to take the belts. Maybe the Viking Raiders, but we kind of, you know, been there and done that with them, and it was kind of a lukewarm run at best that they had. So certainly the Street Profits seem to be now the flavor of the week. And I could absolutely see them winning the belts. And as you said, if you're going to have a one-on-one match at Mania, you can't have the tag belts kind of be collateral damage and not be defended or showcased on the event, because the one of the tag team champions is in a singles match. I mean, so I agree that the tag belts need to come off if he's going to have a one-on-one. And so keep them apart, continue to build the heat, have Kevin Owens cost them the championship, the tag team championship, and then you build to, as you said, it's got to be a street fight. The only thing that you'd have to wonder is if you're going to have a street fight, that, you know, Murphy and the AOP can't be far behind. So what does that mean for Kevin Owens if he doesn't have any backup? I mean, what is stopping Seth Rollins's crew to not beat down Kevin Owens on his behalf if it's an ODQ match? So I would think there has to be something in place, some kind of equalizer for Kevin Owens. I don't know if that is a steel cage. I'm not sure what type of stipulation it would be. Maybe it's just simply all, you know, everyone is barred from ringside, right? And if anyone interferes directly in this match, they will be fired. I mean, something along those lines. We've seen it in WWE before. I'm hesitant if it's a no DQ and nothing else is placed on it, because that, I mean, clearly puts Kevin Owens in the crosshairs of being outnumbered.
I agree. I could see the backup being a combination of the Street Profits and the Big Show. But honestly, I think it'll be because Samoa Joe's obviously out of the picture at this point. I definitely see it being Big Show, because they just want to interject him. It's probably going to be his last Mania. And the Viking Raiders. And that way the Street Profits can be sidebarred into a tag team bout against whoever their number one contender is. So it takes the Street Profits out of the situation once they become the champions. The Big Show, big, huge guy. AOP, two huge guys. Buddy Murphy is one heck of a wrestler, and I'd like to see him do some crazy things. In fact, I wouldn't mind seeing he and the Big Show brawl, and the Big Show maybe putting over some of his wrestling technique just to elevate him when the big man's, you know, in the twilight of his career. And this way it just kind of keeps everybody away from the ring and just lets us have one great match, one technical match, and then it just boils down into a street fight. Maybe get a little color, a little blood. You know, they're not shying away from it as much as they used to. Obviously, you can ask Shayna Baszler about that. And you know, give us a couple high spots, but I'd rather see the actual wrestling side of it. I would love to see the brawling, but I want to see the technical wrestling both inside and outside the ring. It's kind of silly, but if you look back at some like the old classic matches, like show me a figure four on the ramp when you have nothing to grab, nothing to break the move, and it's just agonizing somebody to set up for a knee breaker later that just paints it to, you know, some other kind of knee submission, that kind of thing. It's just stuff I want to see. And I know the two of them could pull it off beautifully.
Well, see, that's the key. You just hit on it. And it's that these two guys are absolutely capable of having a technical wrestling match. And I think it would do a disservice to the fans to not see that and not have them showcase that piece of it if it's just buried in a senseless barroom brawl style match. And while I think that that is something that they could have based on the program that they, and the heat of this program and the nature of this program and how long it's been going on, it typically would, and right now it would warrant a no DQ, just beat the holy hell out of each other type of match. But you can still have that technical match and build to those weapons. Don't immediately go for the chair, right? I mean, start with the lockup. You know, start to work on a body part and move on to, you know, eventually punches after chain wrestling. And then you just keep escalating to build up to those big spots with weapons instead of just having weapons off the bat. So that's absolutely something they could do. I hope they do. I mean, I'm looking forward to it. I think more now than I was, because Kevin Owens got a little bit of his momentum back this week. I just hope he doesn't get cut off at the knees next week. It needs to be something he continues in. As you said, my God, give him a damn win, and he needs it. I don't care if it's against, it doesn't have to be directly against Seth Rollins. It could be against the AOP, a member of the AOP, Buddy Murphy himself. I mean, there's things you can do to give him a momentum, and I'm looking forward to see how they build it. But as you talked about with Shayna Baszler and the Blood, I wanted your take on that segment. I mean, we had all the women out there for the contract signing for the Elimination Chamber. Three or four of them don't even belong out there based on win-loss records and, you know, what have you done in your career as in terms of storyline. I mean, you look at what has Liv Morgan done? What has Sarah Logan done? What has Ruby Riott done? I mean, as a collective group, they are the Riott squad that did absolutely nothing. Nothing. I don't even know if they got more than, you know, one or two wins on their record. I'd love to know their actual record. They were nothing more than sacrificial lambs last year on the road to WrestleMania for Becky Lynch and Ronda Rousey, losing week after week after week after week. And they, I mean, outside of fighting one another, they have done nothing, yet they're in this championship opportunity match. And then you look at Natalya, just kind of a grizzled, respected veteran. You can make a case for her. Asuka losing twice in a row to Becky Lynch, you know, that typically would put you at the back of the line. And yes, of course, Shayna Baszler, who is insanely, insanely favored in this match and should be. But kind of a double-edged sword question. Number one, what did you think of this segment? And then we know what happened with Becky Lynch coming out. And number two, your thoughts on what could happen at Elimination Chamber with these six women. Is it probably going to be what we all think it's going to be?
Yes and no. Okay. Where I see it going is I see that, first of all, we got to do with contract signing spots. It's just terrible. You already know the people are in there. We don't need to sign an official piece of paper. It's a played out scene. Please, for the love of God, can we do away with it? Second of all, Baszler looks so strong, it's unreal. She looks too cool for school. She looks like she's going to come in there. She looks like she's going to take out Randy Orton if she wants to, okay? And that's what I'm loving about Baszler. And my thoughts is going into the Elimination Chamber, I think that they're going to tease maybe Natalya winning, give Asuka a big showing. But the Riott Squad members are going to fight each other so much and keep interfering that it's, I mean, there's only one way to go, and it's Shayna Baszler. I see the Riott Squad as the people that are the distraction. That's going to be the distraction. Every time there's a near fall, it's one of them breaking it up because they can't stand each other, kind of thing. It's going to be not necessarily the Three Stooges act, but it's going to be, to maintain what little momentum they have. And I'm loving the return of Ruby Riott. She's still looking healthy. She's still looking good. And I think it's going to serve to elevate her as the back burner girl, I think. Asuka, like you said, I mean, she's definitely the one who's, odd person out because she's lost so many times now. Her credibility shot. Natalya, of course, nostalgic, but when's the last time she's been really relevant? Really relevant, and it's been a long time. So it's going to come down to Baszler, and I think it's also might just start painting the picture for perhaps a return of Ronda Rousey. And I'm almost thinking we have to look at this realistically, that the strap has been on Becky for over a year. She might be tired. She might want a break. They could be going towards a program of Baszler versus Ronda Rousey, once best friends, now bitter rivals. Yeah, you got to put a little pepper on it, but I can see it going in that direction perhaps. And maybe giving Becky some time off just to recharge her batteries. And, you know, I mean, it's tough being the champion, being at every live event and every Raw. So do you think it could go that direction?
Definitely. I think that's as likely as really you know, any other scenario of maybe even Becky retaining at WrestleMania. I mean, people think it's just a foregone conclusion that not only is Shayna going to win the Elimination Chamber, which she absolutely should. I don't need any cute booking or shock factor wins from anybody. It wouldn't make sense. It would be dumb. And so if Baszler wins, and when she wins, everyone still is now booking two pay-per-views ahead to assume Baszler is going to take out Becky, because Becky has gone now full circle, going a full year with the championship belt. And I see the case for that. I think that is a likely scenario, but I wouldn't rule out Becky Lynch retaining. Now, if she retains and she doesn't recharge her batteries, which again, I'm not advocating for this outcome, I would still go with, let's give it to Shayna, give Becky a recharge of a month, even 2 months, and let her disappear. I think that would absolutely do wonders for her mentally, physically, and give the crowd a break and give the opportunity to miss her, right? The absence makes the heart grow fonder is never more true here. So I'm advocating for that. But you could also make a case, although less likely, of Becky retaining and continuing as champion. But I think you run the risk of Becky Lynch sort of organically turning heel at WrestleMania if they go that road, because I think the fans are ready. They've had their time with Becky. It's been successful as hell, certainly with some bumps in the road, but it has been one of the greatest runs in women's championship history. SmackDown, NXT, when it was the original women's championship, Divas, doesn't matter. This has been probably one of the best, if not, you can make the case for the best run ever. So it's great. It's just time for it to move on. That's all. It's just time for her to drop it and give someone else the championship. But if they don't give it to Shayna and Becky ends up winning, I think that the fans will organically start to turn on Becky. I think you'll even hear that in the reaction at WrestleMania of a much more pro Shayna and anti Becky reaction. At least that's my assumption. Do you think that's possible?
Oh, 100%. It's like you said, how can I miss you if you don't go away? And at this point, like you said, it's a great run. It's a fantastic run. And she's established herself as, I would say, a future legend. But the fact is, if you keep putting the same person on my television every week, right in front of me, and giving me the same old shtick, it becomes my bathroom segment. And I don't want to see that happen to Becky. I think she's too talented, but I don't want to get bored of her either. So she needs a break, and we need a break from her. I'm not saying this is a bad thing. I'm not saying this is a good thing. I'm just saying it's a thing that must be done so we don't turn on her. We can start a fresh chapter with her. Shayna can start her own feud, which I definitely think it's going to be Ronda. I think that they're going to go with the, you know, best friend, a bitter rival kind of thing. Because who can beat Baszler? You come in, you take out the man, you know, and that's going to be a big thing. That's going to be a really big thing after this legendary title run. And there can only be one person. And I hate to say this, but Ronda Rousey's title run was pretty forgettable and pretty bland, in my opinion. But going against somebody like Baszler, where they can throw some of their so-called realism in there, and it's not just a, I'll beat you in 5 seconds because I'm an MMA star versus a wrestler aspect. It's two people who have legitimate backgrounds, two people who are legitimately tough, and I don't want to fight either one of them. I don't think you do either. You know, I think this could be something big. We could really blow this up.
I think it could be. I mean, that is a match that is waiting to happen, and it is one of the quote dream matches that we could think about right now, is Shayna Baszler versus Ronda Rousey. If that is indeed a dream match, I personally, if I was booking this thing, wouldn't immediately run to that after WrestleMania. That to me would be maybe WrestleMania 37, and maybe Shayna Baszler, if she beats Becky at Mania, and again, I think that's likely, you have Shayna duplicate what Becky's done and have a long run where people are just, I mean, at that point, you know, people will be tired of her. It's, we're ready to move on. Shayna's gone through the roster. What are we going to do? There's no one left. And out comes Ronda Rousey. You could do that, or maybe you do it at SummerSlam, but I would make that match at a big four pay-per-view. I would not do it at Backlash or TLC or, God forbid, one of these Saudi Arabia shows. That to me is a WrestleMania or SummerSlam worthy match, and it's going to happen. It's a matter of when, and we all just assume that Ronda's on her way back, and she may not be. I mean, who knows? I would think, though, that in 2020 we do see Ronda Rousey back in the ring, and I think initially she will get a babyface reaction, particularly if it's to oppose Shayna Baszler. that Ronda will be. At the same time, Ronda Rousey, once she turned heel, felt so much better. It felt so, she is just born to be a heel. She's made it very clear that she likes to be a heel, and obviously you can't have heel versus heel because no one gives a damn. So unless Shayna turns babyface and Ronda comes out to be the heel, which you could do, there really are. Now I'm talking myself into so many scenarios. It's just, I mean, just because of the unknown, and that's what I love. And this women's roster continues to just get more and more stacked, and I'm loving this thing right now.
You know, the women's roster is so amazing compared to what it was, you know, 5 or 6 years ago. And, you know, it went from good-looking girls in booty shorts with kick as a finisher to technical wrestling and amazing matches that you can't duplicate. And I for one, am going to say that when I first saw Shayna Baszler debut in NXT, I really didn't think it was going to work right. I thought, okay, you got Ronda Rousey on the main roster. Now you got Shayna Baszler coming up, the four horsemen women of the UFC versus the four horsewomen of the WWE, which I think that is going to be 2 years ahead in WrestleMania, but that's neither here nor there right now. But Baszler, I feel, has established herself as a legit badass more than Ronda Rousey did. Ronda Rousey just plowed through Dana Brooke and Carmella and stuff like that, and people that never really, okay, Carmella's had a run with the belt. Dana Brooke never has. You know, Alexa Bliss is, what, 75 pounds soaking wet? So Baszler has done it against Bianca Belair. She's done it against, I mean, a who's who down in NXT, putting on great matches, and she's honed her craft. Her psychology in the ring is great. Her look, everything. Her ring presence is top notch. It was way better than Ronda's, in my opinion. And I really think her and Ronda can build a story. I think right now Baszler is going to call her own shots for a couple of years to come, definitely.
You hit on it. Her ring presence, Shayna Baszler's ring presence, is something you can't teach. It's just there. Her look is certainly advantageous because she doesn't look like any of the other women. She's not this, you know, this model that's also happens to be an athlete. She looks like she came from a fighting world, and she did. You know, she doesn't have the million-dollar smile. She's not a model, and I love that. Just like when Nia Jax came in and she wasn't the prototypical Barbie figure. I mean, I'm good with that. You need women to stand out that don't all look and feel the same. And Shayna Baszler's look, the fact that she's not as, quote, pretty as the rest of the women, I think is a huge asset to her, not a detriment, because she differentiates herself by the way she looks. And, of course, her promos are very good and her in-ring presence. She's great in the ring. The sky is the limit for Shayna Baszler. So I think she could run roughshod over the Raw Women's Division for the next 6 months. And I'm okay with that. I think it also provides the opportunity for babyfaces to make their presence known, not just Ronda Rousey if she returns, but many others that aren't even being talked about. I mean, where the hell is Nia Jax, right? I mean, we don't even know where she is right now. She's recovering from an injury, but I have said for a month and a half that I expect her to return any day, and she just isn't. And maybe her recovery is, you know, has a setback, or they're waiting for something else to happen to insert Nia Jax. I don't know. But Shayna Baszler, to me, will be the centerpiece of the Raw Women's Division in 2020. Is that a fair statement?
Oh, absolutely. 100%. You know, I don't see anybody taking her out. And it's funny you mentioned Nia Jax. To cement Baszler, I'd have her going over the more brutal designed women like Nia Jax, like Tamina, the ones that just look like they could get in a ring with any guy and kind of throw them around. Because that's what you're going to need, because wins over, I mean, Dana Brooke is stacked. That girl has some muscle, but she doesn't get wins. So beating her isn't going to do anything for you. Beating a member of the Riot Squad is not going to do anything for you. We need wins over people who look like they can hurt you. And that's how it should go. And Baszler is going to be the top for a long time. Absolutely.
And it's funny, as I was watching this past week, or last night rather, Monday Night Raw with Becky and Shayna getting, you know, some punches in on each other, some shots, and then how quickly security and the referees came out to make the save and pulled them apart, I was thinking to myself, imagine if you're Matt Hardy and you're sitting there thinking to yourself, hey, you know, so these women throw a few punches and slaps at each other and you guys are out within, you know, a New York minute. And I got my, you know, I got my ass handed to me last week with two brutal chair shots that could essentially put me in a, you know, a coma or put me in on life support. And you guys don't blink an eye. And after Randy Orton went 20 minutes and just decapitated me last week. But hey, you know, don't let the women you know, throw too many punches at one another. It's just funny whenever it's warranted in the story to build that want to see them fight when security comes to do the pull aparts versus last week when it was determined that while that does take away from some of the realism, it was, at least in the pros and cons, the huge pro was, well, this is just going to be a brutal segment with Randy just gaining more heat, which I agree with. But it's just funny how security can be very selective in when they come out.
It doesn't Matt Hardy have a friend? Just one friend.
I know.
I get you. Now, can I touch upon something real quick, if you don't mind, sir? Okay. I'm loving Carrillo versus Garza. Mm. It is amazing. And, you know, with them being cousins, that match they had is something that they've wanted to do forever, especially those spots being on their heads, slapping each other. It was their moment to say, look at us. It doesn't matter who wins or who loses. We're related. Let's go out there and show them what we can do. Now, I'm going to predict that those guys, they may never be world champions, but they're going to be staples of the WWE roster for a long time. And a reason I think they're going to connect with the Latino community the way that they tried with Sin Cara and Lucha House Party and everything else is because they're not pretending to be somebody else. When you brought in Mystico and made him Sin Cara, and then you said, hey, Latino community, here's your new champion. They said, who is this guy? Mm-hmm. You know, they knew who Rey Mysterio was because Rey Mysterio had a past. He was Rey Mysterio. It didn't work with Alberto Del Rio because he was Dos Caras. In Mexico. So you're saying, okay, he's no longer Dos Caras. Now you're trying to feed us a different personality, somebody we knew. These guys continue to be who they've always been. And between the wrestling, between what they can do with each other, let alone I feel that they're going to end up in a stable with Andrade being managed by Zelina ultimately. It's something I kind of see some foreshadowing on. I think that they are going to connect with the Latino community the way Vince wanted a star to do for a long time. Your thoughts?
I say that I really don't know if I could agree more. This was the first time that I really took a very microscopic lens and looked at Angel Garza. And this week, I will say he reminded me and had shades a little bit of Eddie Guerrero. And I don't, maybe it's his facial hair, maybe it's a little bit of how he wrestles, his body type, but Angel Garza gave me a quick flashes of Eddie Guerrero, and maybe that's just me and the way that my brain it was assimilating those two, but certainly this program with Humberto Carrillo and Angel Garza, I want to see this continue for weeks and weeks and weeks, maybe a few months. I want this to continue. Obviously, when we have Andrade come back, that will be a third party in this interjection of Latino wrestlers. And this could definitely be a reemergence of the Latino wrestling dynamic. Because now you, as you said, you don't have people playing characters. You have them being legitimate stars. You're not rebranding them. They are fresh to the Latino community. They are some of the best performers on the roster, bar none. I mean, the Spanish Fly that Angel Garza and Humberto Carrillo performed was absolute perfection, the way that it was performed and executed. I wish they gave them more time. I would like to see them in a 20, 25-minute match. Honestly, like these are candidates for true Iron Man matches where it would entertain me from start to finish. I know that a true Iron Man match, 60-minute match, hasn't happened in like 15 years. But I mean, I don't even know. I think the last Iron Man match, and I'm sure someone will correct me, might have been The Rock versus Triple H at Judgment Day 2000. I mean, I really don't know the last Iron Man match that there was. Maybe Brock and Kurt Angle. They might have had one. But my point is that the style of these two, it's a joy to watch. They are both intriguing characters. We still have a lot to learn, and they certainly have character development to do. But I'm loving what I'm
Yes.
seeing.
I'm just blown away about in NXT, both these guys were treated as enhancement talent. And it was like Aleister Black needs a win, so feed him Garza, feed him Carrillo, feed him, And since making the main roster, both have done nothing but impress. And it's like when you and I discuss Buddy Murphy, like being strong in defeat. No matter who loses, we are the winner. We get to see a great match. We don't get to see some squash match or somebody who's under talented going over somebody who's talented. We get to see a great entertaining match. And like you said, give me an hour Iron Man match. That'd be awesome. Let's put some stakes on it. I think the perfect booking is that maybe one could lose services to the Okay, let me try to reiterate this to make it make more sense. Maybe the stakes in this whole thing could be if you lose, you have to be managed by Selena Vega. Andrade comes back. Now you have the three of them together. But instead of your typical three-man Freebird rule or something like that, I would have them making their whole life's accomplishment to try to retire Rey Mysterio because he's a beloved hero. And with Rey Mysterio trying to get his son into wrestling, it'd be a good segue to help out Dominic. It could, if you're going to reuse Cain Velasquez, which it is what it is, you know they're going to use him sooner or later. You've got an excuse to do that. And Mysterio's not going to be around forever. His body hurts. He's older than me. It's time for him to pass the torch. One of these gentlemen will be elevated in it. And you have a great storyline that will be remembered forever.
I like that. And Ray, as you said, he's as you mentioned earlier with Big Show about being the twilight of his career. Rey Mysterio certainly is, and I think that WWE and the fans got more out of Rey in his second run in WWE than I thought anybody thought they could ever get out of him. I mean, it looks like he hasn't missed a step since he came back, and it's just crazy. But Father Time, I think, is catching up to him. And I totally understand that, and I would love to see him continue, but I don't know how much he has left in the tank. So I think for the time being, what's going to happen is Rey will team with Umberto against Angel Garza Alberto Del Rio. I'm thinking of what's his name? Geez, Andrade. I got that mixed up. So Andrade and Angel Garza are probably going to be in some kind of tag match with Rey and Humberto Carrillo. I would assume that's probably going to take place at WrestleMania. And my guess, unfortunately, the way WWE books, I could see that tag match. Again, this doesn't even exist yet, but it looks like they're headed that way. For being on the pre-show of WrestleMania, I think it deserves the main card, but this seems to be based on the history of their booking that it probably is going to be a pre-show match. And just it's one of those matches that WWE views as it's exciting. It gets the people on their feet. It gets them kind of revved up for the real show. They look at it as kind of, to use your food analogies, kind of an appetizer for what's to come in the main card of WrestleMania. So unfortunately, I don't agree with that, but I think that's probably how WWE views these four men in their tag match, again, that doesn't exist yet, for WrestleMania. What do you think that's a possibility or likely?
It's really likely. I find the pre-show matches to be disrespectful, especially if a title is defended on it, US or Intercontinental or tag titles. It's just disrespectful all the way around. It would be like having, you know, this great match, like you said, and it's on the pre-show, but yet you have a 24/7 title segment on the main card, and it doesn't work for me. I want to see these guys open it up. This could be Rey's last WrestleMania. And if it is, I definitely want to see him go to the performance center and become a trainer, which I think that's ultimately the plan. But if it's going to be his send off, you do it on the main card. It's just the way to go. Let's establish a couple of new stars. Andrade, we know he's fantastic. And if nobody has ever saw what he did as La Sombra in Mexico, please look it up. His matches with Nakamura and other people were just mind blowing. You know, you have three fresh faces. I mean, because Andrade is still very fresh to the WWE community. You have a legend in Rey Mysterio. You have a story. You have the table set. It's perfect. Put it on the main card. Even if it's the curtain jerker, give us 15 to 20 on it and just let it happen. Make it organic. Let's send Rey off the way he should go.
I'm with you. I totally am. And I know that we're running up against time a little bit, so there's one more thing about Raw that I want to ask you about, and then I want to get some very quick hits on your predictions for the Super Showdown. I'll just run down the matches. You tell me who you think is going to win. So the last thing I want to talk to you about on Raw is Drew McIntyre and his sit-down interview with Charlie. What did you think about this? He talked about how this is, you know, basically went through his history, how he was the chosen one. And the biggest line to me that came out of this is that he left a boy and came back a man. I mean, I thought he was authentic here. I thought this did a lot of progression in his character to being likable and humanizing Drew, which I think they've done a great job of over the last month. What did you think about this? Were you as big a fan of this sit down as I was?
Well, I am, and I'm going to tell you why. Last we spoke, a couple of weeks ago, I had said he was never known as a great orator, and I believe that less is more as far as his promos went. It was good for him to have an extended interview. It was great for him to talk about being only 21 years old and being the chosen one and being a fresh-faced kid. And it's funny, if you look at that footage of him being introduced, he looked nervous in that ring, like, I got to get out of here. And, you know, and that's your debut to the world. That's some scary stuff. And you had the weight of the world put on your shoulders. Next thing you know, you're joining three-man band and you're losing to Hornswoggle and Ryback and stuff. And so I love the fact that he's saying, you know, I was a kid. And so I left and I went to the Indies and I grew up. I became a man. And it's also saying, you know, that time can change things, that it's almost asking forgiveness for those times where he had to act as an enhancement talent. You know, like, okay, the crowd at some point is going to say, you know, you used to be in 3-on-1 squash masters on the losing side. So this is his way of saying, I was young. I didn't know what I was doing. And now I'm fully grown and I can do this. And I'm in the driver's seat. I'm no longer, you know, riding in the back seat anymore. I'm ready for it. I am now really the chosen one.
Yeah, this was very good, as you said. You know, he talked about his past. He even talked about how he was bitter, really bitter, and had a huge chip on his shoulder after he left WWE. But he said that ultimately, in the end, he had to just look in the mirror and blame the guy that he was staring at for why he's in that position. But then he came back in 2017 to NXT, came back to Raw in 2018 after becoming NXT champion. And then, I mean, I was concerned when he was being kind of Shane McMahon's lackey. We discussed that, I think, last week. But obviously where he's at now is where I think most fans believe he should be, in the main event, competing for a championship, a guy that's never gotten an opportunity for the top belt. So I think this is where people want him to be, and I believe it's going to be a very, very, very pro-Drew McIntyre crowd in Tampa on April 5th. So, all right, I know we got a couple minutes left. So with that couple minutes, I just want to run down the card on Super Showdown just to hear your predictions. I know you don't have time to dive in. But Universal Championship match, The Fiend, Bray Wyatt versus Goldberg. Who do you have?
Oh, God, this is the toughest one to call. but I'm going to go with a bad prediction, say Goldberg.
All right. Wow. Yeah, I was very tempted on that as well. I could see why. And boy, if that's true, you're going to have a lot of fans boo the hell out of that. You know, I hope it happens from the perspective of just to hear the crowd reaction, to see the people hashtagging cancel WWE Network. People will literally lose their minds just for the reaction to that. So I'm kind of in a very sick way rooting for that. The WWE Championship, Brock Lesnar versus Ricochet.
Brock Lesnar, obviously.
Okay. Raw Tag Team Championship, Rollins and Murphy versus the Street Profits.
I'm going with the Street Profits. We got to get that ball rolling for the Owens feud.
I couldn't agree more. SmackDown Tag Team Championship, The New Day versus the John Morrison and The Miz.
I honestly want a New Day. I'm going to go with the New Day. That's what I really like at this point, because I think that Morrison's potential is being wasted being tagged up with The Miz.
Yeah, I agree. My prediction's the opposite, but I agree with John Morrison just being put exactly back where he was before he left. I mean, it's bizarre, and it's just telling of WWE and how they view him. Anyway, Corbin versus Reigns in a steel cage match.
Reigns.
And hopefully for the last time ever. SmackDown Women's Championship, Bayley versus Naomi.
Oh, this is another one that's really tough to call. Mm-hmm. I don't know why Naomi's really getting this spot. I mean, it's out of nowhere kind of thing for me. I would say the smart move is to keep it on Bayley, but I have a feeling it's going to be Naomi, so I'm going to go with Naomi.
All right. And then Tukwai, I can't pronounce it. I'm terrible with that stuff. The Trophy Gauntlet match. I know how to pronounce those words. Rey Mysterio, R-Truth, AJ Styles, Andrade, Eric Rowan, and Bobby Lashley.
Oh, the sexy pick is AJ Styles. The WWE pick is Bobby Lashley. What I personally want is Andrade, but it's WWE, so I'm going to go with R-Truth. Just give it to him.
Because, well, they are good at giving R-Truth things that don't matter. So, exactly. Yeah, I agree. All right. Well, I think that we covered pretty much everything. I know that we didn't have a whole lot of time, but we made the most of it. And it's always a blast to have you on the show. But I want to give you an opportunity if you want to let people know, if they want to get in touch with you, email or Twitter or whatever you want to give out. This is your chance. So go ahead.
Sure. Can I also do a couple of quick shout outs? If you don't mind.
Absolutely. Go for it.
Okay. I want to shout out to a lady named Michelle who listens to this. I see her almost every day when I get my snacks for work, and she's a huge Shayna Baszler fan, a huge Ronda Rousey fan, and if I don't say her name, she's probably going to boot me in the skull, and we don't need that. You can reach me at 144Captain on Twitter. As always, it's very humbling, and it's so amazing to be on the show, and I look forward to doing it again and again with you whenever we can. The other shout out I want to give is to the Kevin Cerrito podcast. He's a friend of mine from Memphis. This past week he had Austin Idol on. He's had Lawler on. He's had Daniel Bryan on. He's a good guy. He's very knowledgeable. And it's a lot of fun. And for all you people who follow the indies, there's a gentleman. You can find him on Twitter. His name is JXT, the J-Stick. He's out of Australia, and my prediction is that this man is going to be in NXT within the next 2 years. I would say start following him now. He is an amazing performer, and that's all I've got to say.
All right, very good. And I will say a couple prayers so you don't get kicked in the skull, right? So I will be – I'll cross my fingers. Don't do it. You know, don't get inspired by Randy Orton, right? So let's maybe – an RKO is okay, but a kick, you know, a punt to the skull is where we draw the line. So, all right. Well, thank you so much, Michael. It's been a blast. As always, we'll have you back on in, you know, whenever our schedules match up. So looking forward to it.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, sir.
All right. Have a good night.
All right. Bye. Goodbye.